principle one, decide what's important around here. 8:30 is important around here. One of my clients is a former Marine Lieutenant Colonel. He's one of the guys who's hooked in being punctual, and in him, 8:30 means 8:30. We start work at 8:30, not 8:35. He lets prospective employees know this, but sometimes they don't realize how important 8:30 really is. For example, soon after starting work here, Bill arrived at 8:45 one morning. My client noticed that this had asked him, "What's up, Bill? You're a little late." "Well, bad traffic today," Bill answered. "Plan for that was we started at 8:30. 3 weeks later, Bill showed up at 9:30. "My kids were up sick last night. I didn't get much sleep, and I slept in a little bit longer," he said. My clients didn't respond right away. He had kids too, but the next response was, "Bill, 8:30 is when we all start. Is that clear?" 5 weeks later, Bill showed up at 10:45. As he was busily going about his work, my client came up to him, fuming mad. "8:45? Don't you remember our previous discussion on the importance of getting you to work at 8:30? "But boss, I stayed late to work last night to finish the hot project that you assigned me to, and I thought you'd understand me coming in a little bit later in the morning." "Well, I don't. 8:30 is what's important around here. It doesn't seem like we fit. You just don't understand what's important around here. To understand what's important around here, who hasn't been in the same type of situation where actions can't be explained on rational basis? Yet situations like this occur because every potential leader has some things that he or she fails in that's very important. Every potential leader has something that he or she feels are very important. It's that we do these things around here, or the way that we'll change is to do things differently around here. It's the way we do things around here, or the way we will change and do different things differently around here. These basic values, the answers to our questions, what's important around here, from the platform from which all leaders operate, there is a foundation on which all directions and plans are built. There's an underlying principles that will be lived up to, or you cannot survive in the organization. There's an underlying principles that will be lived up to, or you cannot survive in the organization. What are the 8:30s in your life? 8:30 is what's important around here. Remember, what is the 8:30s in your life? What are the 8:30s in your life? What personal idiosyncrasies drive your work day? What personal idiosyncrasies drive your work day? How do they affect the people that you want to follow you? "I want 10,000 fireflies over there. I want 10,000 fireflies over there." Walt Disney was walking through Disney World before its completion with a small group of department heads. Suddenly, he stopped, pointing to a specific area, and said, "I want 10,000 fireflies over there." The head of construction asked him when. Notice that the man did not say, "But Walt, where could we possibly find 10,000 butterflies? Or wouldn't 5,000 be sufficient?" Perfection, absolute top quality was the value here. "Just do it, please," the man said. "When?" No second guessing, just when. He understood that for Mr. Disney, perfection was a value. Value that himself obviously bought into. What we have here is a fit between the values of leaders, the followers, and the organization. What we have here is to fit between the values of the leader, the values of the followers, and the values of the organization. In order to fit this, in order to have this fit, however, it's important that your potential followers understand your values, what's important to you. You need to clarify and clearly define this for them. That's the first step, is to clear to them what's important and what your values are. Then you must discuss the values that are important to them. That's the second step. Final, together, you both need to discover the values that are actually being demonstrated in your organization. What makes your place tick? What values have created your corporate culture? Only after these three ingredients have you discovered the clearly stated you can make it fit with mutual values. 10,000 fireflies, no problem. Again, you have to finally together need your discovering values that are actually being demonstrated in your organization. Discover your mutual values. In discovering your values, you and your employees begin to premise that most people have honest, honorable values. They're also good and neither unethical nor immoral. If you are to be a leader, you need to discover your mutual values, the ones that you want to live and to feel good about. One way to do this is to have a professional leadership seminar with a facilitator who can run and discover our mutual values. This session can also and should get hot. People are justifiably passionate about what's important to them. For example, let's take the great value of integrity, which I define as doing what you say you'll do for me. That's integrity. I'll do what I'll say I'll do for you. For me, this is the key value in our business, and it seems like a simple to me. When I'm involved with people who follow this principle, our value is to do what you say you'll do. Things will go smoothly. There are no surprises. Outcomes can be predicted with a fair degree of accuracy. Integrity is doing what you say you're going to do. When I find myself in new relationships with people who do not do what they say they will do, I'm exasperated, to say the least. In fact, I'm mad at these people, and I violated my trust in them, that they have violated my trust in them. What's happening here? Our values are not mutually shared. Here are some values that I've discovered and people like to hash out so they can really define what's important around here to call to all of us. It's a way to find out what's important around here to all of us. Number one, integrity. Do what you say you'll do. Integrity, to do what you say you'll do. Growth. We want to be bigger. Growth is king. Growth. We want to be bigger. We want to be bigger. It's growth here. Profit. At all costs, the bottom line will be good. At all costs, the bottom line will be good. Professionalism. Be the best that you can be at your job. Professionalism. The best you could be at your job. Great service. Deliver legendary service. So good it's legendary. Service. Positive attitudes. Grumps don't fit in here. Grumps just don't work around here. Positive attitudes. Common enemy. We'll do anything to beat the XYZ company. Common enemy. We'll do anything to beat the XYZ company. Take risks. We must try new ideas, even if that means failing many, many, many times. Hungry and attracted to the risk of failing, to taking risks. Give 110% always. This will not be a sleepy place. But give 110% always. This will not be a sleepy place. There'll be no laziness ever. Sit forward, up, confident, energy. 110%. No laziness. Self-management. Do what needs to be done without always asking, is this okay, before acting. Self-management. Do what needs to be done. Do what needs to be done without asking, is this okay, before acting. Quality is king. Nothing goes out of our place that's second rate. Quality. Quality, quality, quality. Nothing goes out of our place that's second rate. No action, no decision, no thought is going to be second rate. Quality is king. In the space, just write down some of the values currently most important to you. Number one, a positive mental attitude. Number two, your goals and dreams. Number three, enthusiasm practice. Number four is looking at the bright side of things no matter what. Number five is trying to become better. Number six is leading by example. Once you've looked at your values as a business person, I suggest that you look at your personal values. This will balance you out. The next section will discover what really makes you tick. Discover what makes you tick. As I was about to turn 50 years old, I found myself at the end of a business trip in Europe. I've been training Time Magazine's European sales force, and now I was about to take a 6-day vacation alone. It was the first time I'd ever done that. On a previous visit, my wife and I had discovered fabulous Gasthof in Obermeiming, Austria, and headed to the magnificent spot Gasthof Schwarz is a tiny village surrounded by mountains that allow the spirit to soar. On a sun-drenched patio on my first morning there, I sipped my coffee after a full breakfast. My thoughts were wandering in the fact that I would be turning 50 in 4 months. I almost never think about my age, but 50 had a big ring to me. My life was more than half over. I just had a very, very good life. But I found myself asking, why has it been so good? What have I been doing and why? So I started to write down my thoughts in a very self-spur-of-the-moment process, and it made me tick. For just about 50 years of my life, for the first 50 years of my life, I discovered many things. For instance, I realized that we all act out our lives in a way or in another. I discovered that we all act out our lives in one way or another. Many times I had not been able to understand why I did what I did, felt what I felt, dreamed what I dreamed. Vague direction can mold a good deal of our lives and much of mine. But the process of discovering what makes us tick awakens personal reflection on the factors in our lives that move us into action, that fuel our dreams. It's a process intended to make you happier, more satisfied with your life. Discovering the positive elements in my life and how each one makes me tick has allowed me to increase the time I spend doing the things that I value. The process that has worked for me, which is why I think I've done and I will do the same for you. The process worked for me, and I believe and think it will do the same for you. Once you have more clearly defined these values for yourself, you will obviously be able to communicate them better with others. Now practice the values, and once you'll be able to surround yourself with people who have the same values, below are some of the values that I found people often care passionately about. What are the values that you care passionately about? Number one, personal integrity. Doing what you believe in, doing what you care about, and feel that it's ethical and important. Your personal integrity. Doing what you believe in, care about, and feel is ethical and important. Number two, personal growth, becoming steadily wiser, more balanced, and more connected with other people. Your personal growth, what are you doing for personal growth? Your positive attitude, looking at what's useful, beneficial, and worthwhile in each situation. Through your positive attitude, looking at what's useful, beneficial, and worthwhile in each situation. Self-determination. Being able to choose what you do and how you do it and when you do it. Your self-determination. Being able to choose what you do and how and when you do it. Serenity. Serenity. Feeling alert, yet at peace. Changing with what you can about the world and accepting what you can't. Serenity. Feeling alert, yet at peace. Changing what you can about the world and accepting what you can't. Financial security. Having the money, talents, and or the opportunities to keep yourself and your family free from fiscal difficulties or worries is your financial security. You have to have financial security for having money and your talents and the opportunities to keep yourself and your family free from fiscal difficulties and worries. Time. Spending it with your family and friends and personal interests and or your own thoughts. You got to spend your time with your family, your friends, your personal interests, and your own thoughts. Number one is your family. Joy. Feeling effective, energized, and dynamic part of the universe. Joy is feeling effective, energized, and a dynamic part of the universe. To have joy is to feel dynamic, to feel energized and upbeat, and to feel effective. In the space that follows, those are some values that are currently most important to you in the facts of your life. These you don't have to be from a list, but the forms of your values is the positive mental attitude, the enthusiasm, the constantly search for the positive outlook on any situation, to enthuse and arouse enthusiasm in your friends, to be honest in eye contact, and to always think in the better interest of your friends and family. And if it seems like you're becoming selfish, you're really not. You really need to have your people understand that you're helping them if you are, or maybe you can have them understand that you're helping them. Now, you really should know that what's important to you is what about other people in your organization? What makes them tick? And what values does not your organization demonstrate whether you agree with them or not? You can make your life your own by understanding what makes you tick. Understand what makes you tick, and you can make your life your own. Discover what makes others tick. Now, to discover what makes others tick. In a few pages, I'll show you how to take an organization through a process of discovering what's most important to the people in it, deciding together what values and the companies will live by in the future. I can call this process a vision quest, and it can do more with your organization than any number of seminars or motivational quality management theories. Once and before I began a vision quest, my client told me, "Bob, I have two companies here. You have to practice your vision quest, vision quest, your vision quest." Even though you see only the company's name, we really have two totally different companies. There are two sets of answers to what's important around here. There's two sets of answers to what's important around here. We talked more about this and became clear about it. There are two different sets of values being acted upon, which turn created two cultures, an example, two companies. This person's arm as a company was focused primarily on providing ever more effective and competitive service to customers, but outside of his division, service scarcely seemed to be concerned. Everyone else seemed to be more focused ultimately on entirely the growth of increasing the bottom line profit. This problem exists in many organizations, and I can take that form of different sets of answers to the questions, but what's important around here? What's important around here? By department or division or location, obviously when that happens, the departments or divisions or locations cannot, by definition, be heading in the same direction. It's impossible. No synergy between departments means the loss of cooperative energy in achieving the goals of the organization. There can also be two versions of what's important when a company talks about one set of values, sometimes very loudly, but acts on quite another. For instance, an organization may emphasize quality over in its advertisements, public relation pieces, and in-house publications, but in its day-to-day operations, the actual business is getting things done. Management may, in fact, be far more concerned with high output and low production costs than with quality. A simple exercise I suggest you do before you do a vision quest is what I call an organizational values matrix. Organizational values matrix. You do it by yourself first. Later, you may wish to have your key people do it. Its purpose is to help you define as well as discover the values that make different people tick. And those values are not necessarily yours, but that have become organizational values. Some of them you may like others. Others you may not agree with at all. But here's the exercise. Number one, list your values. What makes you tick? What's important to you in the left column of the values matrix? In the left column. Number two, write your name, the names of the key people in your organization across the top that you can create a matrix by department, division, location, etc. Number three, on a 1 to 10 scale of being low and 10 being high, rank how you see yourself and other people demonstrating a behavior, the attitude, and a belief in a particular value. The values matrix is for your key people. List in this column what you believe should be important around your place. Rate yourself on a 1 to 10. Rate each listed person on a scale of 1 to 10, low, 1 being low, 10 is high, to the key people. This value matrix should give you a clear idea of exactly where in your organization there's a synergy where you have conflict. Well, you'd be surprised at just how revealing this simple chart can be. By thinking about other people's values and how they affect one another, you can get a new perspective on how things and why things happen as they do. When you look at people's values and behaviors and follow the rules that they live by, you can be more easily seen why certain difficulties have arisen and where you have been most likely to arise. Discover what makes your organization tick. Your next step is to look at your organization as a whole. What behaviors it routinely exhibits and what rules it lives by. Spend a few new minutes thinking about what values your company follows. Not necessarily the ones that claim to follow or any ones that they necessarily claim to follow or the ones that other people follow to feel is important, but the values that the organization as a whole acts on and puts into practice day by day. List the most important of these values below by descending order of importance. Refer back to the list of common values page 18 ideas, you'll see, and don't feel limited by them. Once you've listed these values, look at them carefully. Do they create a synergy? Are they in conflict with one another? Do they lend themselves in a clear plan or direction, or do they take the organization in several different directions at once? So again, list the most important of these values descending in order of importance. The common values are on page 18, ideal for you to like, but don't feel limited by them. Write down your organization's values 1 through 6. Now, I'd like you to see what kind of fit between the company's values. Those are the key people in it. To do this, fill the organization values matrix in the following page. List the organizational values in the left-hand column in descending order of importance. Write your own name and the names of the key people in the organization across the top. Once again, you can create the matrix by department, division, location, or any other category you choose. On a scale 1 to 10, 1 being low, 10 being high. Rank on how you see yourself and other people's demonstrating a behavior and attitude as a belief of a particular organizational value. Organizational values matrix. Discovering how you and others feel about the organization demonstrated values. Organization values 1 through 6. Scale of 1 to 10, how you feel about how you are and then how your key people are. It is probable that the three types of values do not really fit together. Therefore, in a vision quest, you need to hash out what's really important around here. What's really important around here? Your values, other people's values, organizational values all connect like strings into the center, and you must get agreement between what your people value and what the organization values. What you have just done is powerfully important. You have defined how you perceive the differences between what's important to you, what's important to others, and the difference between what's important to the organization and what's important to you and to the others. You, others, organization all come down in the three threads to the center, where these mutual values are what you'll talk about always. These mutual values is what all three of you guys will talk about always. Now, the task is to agree on set mutual values so that everyone can say, "You bet, that's important to me." People can soar, not soar. People can soar, not soar. The key to success in mutual values of the organization is to understand that people never soar only when their personal values are in agreement with the organization's value. People will soar only when their personal values are in agreement with the organization's values. They will not soar if these values are not in agreement. You have to have your people's values in agreement with the organization's values. Then your people will soar. If your values are out of sync with the company's, you are in the wrong place. It's not the organization's values that are wrong, or yours are right, or vice versa. It's just that they don't match. You probably don't need to divorce from each other, not just because you're doing it feels bad. Plus, you cannot soar with the values if they're not shared. You just can't. If you decide to stay, you'll always want to be disgruntled, irritated, and frustrated. You won't live up to your own potential, and you know it. Two extremely important types of business relationships are those who are your employees and of your vendors. Here are some suggestions to match up your organization's values with your employees and your vendors. You can soar. Number one, during the hiring process, ask a prospective employee to talk about his or her personal values as well as the values of the person he's looking or the values of the person he's looking for in his organization. Number two, give the prospective employee a list of 10 or 15 values any organization might hold. Include in the list of your organization's values, ask the person to rank 1 to 10 on scale how he feels are really important. In the discussion that follows, you and your prospective employees will discover if you both fit, or better yet, whether the person will soar once employed. When entering the relationship, which you hope will long-term with a vendor and entirely appropriate to discuss your organization's values and vendors, get these values down in front of you on a paper. Look at the key overlapping areas of agreement. See that there are some major areas of disagreement. After all, you want a long marriage with employees and vendors, not a short-term honeymoon followed by a divorce. Some facts about values. A fact. Values drive organizations. A fact is about values is that that values drive people. Values drive organizations, and it's values that drive everything that's important. Everything you do is based basically on the values, but once you live your life. a fact. Values shape your attitude and how you develop people. Values shape your policies and how you treat personal issues. Your values control your procedures and how fast you do things. Your values are in control of your activities and how and if you really celebrate victories. So the fact is, the values shape your attitudes, your policies, procedures, and activities. A fact is, values are always being demonstrated. You can't hide your values, no matter how you are, with your hair or your outfits. You can't hide them. You can't claim you have certain value and then act differently, or you'll be correctly labeled a hypocrite. You can't hide them. You can't claim that you have a certain value and then act differently. You'll be correctly labeled a hypocrite. A fact is, values are create your organization's culture, how they place lives as an entity. A fact that you, as a potential leader, have values. You already know what's important to you. Therefore, you need to clearly state those values onto others. You must visualize them. Make no mistake about it. These are the values that are important to me. Be laser clear and be brief. Then find out who agrees with you and who will not follow you. And those who don't, won't, and shouldn't. Fact is, once you get people to agree with you on set mutual values, business objectives will be more easily defined. Organizational direction is based on what you value. People will now be easily able to buy in or buy out, to agree or disagree with the direction. All business objectives are based on values. Values. What you end up talking about. The groundwork has been laid. The homework has been done. Now you have discovered that, number one, what's important to you. Number two, what's important to your people. Number three, what the organization has been demonstrated is important. What the organization has been demonstrating is important. Number four, agreement on your mutual values, the values you are collectively passionate about. Leaders need to continue to drive home the organizational shared values every time they speak. The leaders need to continually drive home the organizational shared values every time they speak. Why people can identify what us are passionate about in the terms of what the culture is going to be like so that they can thrive on it. You'll have a group of people who can now tackle the question, where are we headed? When a leader can constantly talk about the values of everything that they have agreed to, there is a buy-in by the followers. You know what the organization's fundamental principles are, keeping their own values? Since there is no sense of ownership when these shared values are talked about, people who tend to come in decision faster and define objectives more easily. I like an emotional and psychological goose every time you hear the leader talk about the shared mutual values of the organization. It's like an emotional and psychological goose every time you hear the leader talk about the shared mutual values of the organization. You say to yourself, those are my values too. Let's tackle that problem. So what's important around here? Chapter 1 checklist. Number 1, discover what makes you tick. More important to you and what are your values? Discover what makes you tick. What's important to you and what are your values? Number 2, discover the values of those whom you wish to lead. Number 3, discover the organization's values. Number 4, discover the mutual values. Discover the mutual values. Realize that it's smart to have shared values. Number 5, get agreement on what's important around here. 6, all business objectives are based on values. 7, the strength of organization and the strength of the shared values within it. 8, leaders must continue to drive home the organization's shared values every time they speak. Decide what's important around here. Principle 2, ask, where are we headed? The normal situation in most organizations, few employees can answer the question, where are we headed? In fact, a recent Booz Allen and Hamilton study revealed that only 30% of the senior officials think other key managers clearly understand the business goals. Well, that's not so good. However, it's normal. How does this happen? Because no clear direction has been established by the leader. Or if one has been established, it hasn't been communicated forcefully or memorably enough to the people to know where they are headed. A leader without a vision, a direction in which he or she wants to take the organization, is simply not a leader. A leader without a vision, a direction in which she or she wants to take an organization, is simply just not a leader. You gotta have vision. A leader without a vision has no rally cry. Therefore, inconsistent messages are utterly every time the person opens his or her mouth. No one really can answer with any clarity or conviction that the big question is, where is our organization headed? Our leader's vision, untitled. How can you have your vision untitled? The secret to creating a vision is first having defined your shared values. Once you have your values understood, you can create your vision. Once organizations absorb the obvious wisdom of defining shared values first, then the next logical question is to have answered as a leader is where are we headed? With all the people here who want to work together. Too often, however, the question is where are we headed? Asked too soon. There's almost no discussion, at least not in front in a formal sort of way, the key question that I believe here comes first is, what's important around here? Once you have what's important around here, you want to ask, where are we headed? At a recent vision quest I was conducting, I asked all the key players a simple question. How big do you want to be the dollar volume in 3 years? And then I added, okay, now tell me your current annual sales so that I can have a benchmark from where we'll be moving from. To my astonishment, of the 13 people in front of me, only 4 knew the current annual sales. 2 of these were the owners, so really only 2 others knew where they were going. Now, let alone where they wanted to go. By the way, the 13 people were the key department heads of a 128-person company. The 2 owners were flabbergasted. They also quickly learned that their communication to the troops of what's up lately had been sorely lacking. The secret to creating a vision is to first having defined your shared values. And once you got a current annual sales establishment, we moved on to, now what do we want to, now what do we want that number to be in 3 years from now? Everyone thought, took some calculators, some puzzled out, had no control. They had no control over the next issue to begin with. And I went around to the room, so everyone's forecast, and put the numbers up on the flip chart. Everyone was amazed. The range was from essentially no growth over the 3 years to slightly more doubling in size. So it was the same 3 years. Some valued aggressive growth and essential, while others saw it in a downright stupid. Others were either elated or scared because it was important to them by challenging, by asking, how fast should we grow? When starting to define that, how fast should we grow, or where are we headed, I played this example more than 100 times in the last 14 years, and I've conducted vision quests for organizations. The key to answering where are we headed lies in the first answering, what's important around here? If you choose to violate the principles, you'll define a vision that will not be supported by everyone, and some people will work actively to sabotage your vision because it's not based on what is important to them. What's a vision? A leader needs to possess a spark of genius, the ability to assemble from a wide variety of inputs and historical data a clearly articulated vision of the future. The vision needs to be, number one, simple. The vision needs to be easily understood. It needs to be clearly desirable by all, and it needs to be energizing. 1 through 4, it needs to be simple, easily understood, clearly desirable by all, and energizing. Warren Bennis describes a vision of condition that is better than some important ways now of what we know exists. Warren Bennis describes a vision as a condition that is better in some important ways than what now exists. It's something that's better in some important ways than what now exists. John Nesbitt of the Reinventing the Corporation calls vision the link between dream and action. A vision has a wholeness about it. It's not just a sales forecast of what's going to reach $350 million in sales in 5 years. It's exciting. If it's exciting, isn't that exciting? That's not a vision. I mean, just talking about we're going to reach $350 million in sales in 5 years. Isn't that exciting? That's not a vision. A vision must be realistic and sellable to the team. Some time ago, I had a client, a company whose president had a vision and growth for far outstripped for anyone's imagined could be achieved. It simply seemed totally unrealistic. In addition, the president made the initial mistake of trying to force people to believe it. When that obviously was not working, we held values and vision quests. His key people redefined the achievable vision based on their mutual values, and because they believed in it, it became achievable. Lee Iacocca is one of the outstanding examples of someone who created a vision of success that mobilized large factions of employees to align behind it. He empowered them. So what can we say about the vision that a second step of leadership without there is no focus? A good vision grabs its passion, helps transform purpose, where you want to be, into action almost automatically. A strong vision is compelling. It pulls people towards it. It commits people to action. It converts followers into leaders. Vision gives an organization a glimpse in its collective potential. It gives meaning to why they belong to an organization. And it answers, where are we going? It defines direction, the vision. No one has expressed vision more clearly than Fred Smith, CEO of Federal Express, in the book Absolutely Positively Overnight. That's the crystal clear vision, a stake in the ground, a rallying point to summarize, a vision to condition that is better than some important ways than what now exists. It's a vision, it's a condition that is better in some important ways than what now exists. A vision, number one. A vision grabs, it focuses, arouses passion, transforms purpose into action, compels, pulls people towards it, commit people into action, drives a stake in the ground, says that's what will be, becomes a rallying point. If you know what you think and want, you'll have a very real good advantage of achieving it. A vision grabs, focuses, arouses passion, transforms purpose into action, compels, pulls people towards it, commits people to action, drives a stake in the ground, says that's what will be, becomes a rallying point. but this is still nothing to get too excited about. A vision created solely by the boss is hard to sell to the troops. Therefore, you need to create a mutual vision. Without it, you'll be all alone with your grand vision, and no one will own it but you, and no one will really help you get there. You have to have a vision. I have a vision. I have a different vision, equally good vision. I think my vision is best, so there. If you have three people, and each of them have a sign on their chest, one, I have a vision. Two, I have a different vision, but equally good vision. Number three, I think my vision is best, so there. We have no mutual vision. About 5 years ago, I was holding a presentation skills workshop for Gardner Advertising, a large rational advertising agency in St. Louis. The agency's top 8 people were in my session. The specific presentation exercise was to answer the question, why am I hanging around Gardner Advertising? The purpose was to allow each partner to present from the heart. The first two presenters did a good job talking about the people they love to work with, creating challenges, etc. Then a bomb was dropped. The third presenter, who happened to be the senior client services person in the agency, said, the reason I'm hanging around is because we used to be good. We're not good now. We still have great people, but we have no mutual vision. I'm hanging around in case we define our mutual vision because it would be so exciting to be good again. Each of the next four presenters echoed the exact same thoughts and all using the same term, mutual vision. But they never did define their mutual vision. The president never wanted to take time to discover what wasn't really important to his people and his direction he wanted to be headed. He was always too busy of handling the current business. It's sad, but since the company never decided where it was headed based on shared values, today is totally literally out of business. Today it is totally and literally out of business. The doors are closed. Hundreds of people are out of work. People are aching to be committed to something. People love to be committed to something. It's the leader's responsibility to define what that something is. Benefits of a mutual vision. The most compelling reason for a crystal clear mutual vision is that it gives us all people in the organization a point on which to focus their skills and brain power. It gives them the chance to be as good as they think that they are. The keys to developing a mutual vision are to understand that a mutual vision allows for self-motivation. A mutual vision allows for self-motivation. The keys to developing a mutual vision to understand that, number one, you cannot mandate the vision or impose it on potential followers. Number two, like any other product, your vision is something that you must sell. It does no good to go to the mountaintop and dream up your vision all alone. If you do, you'll find yourself also alone and buying into it and trying to make it happen. You simply cannot mandate your vision and have others help you get there. Therefore, the first question can inspire leaders. Much answer is what do my people want? You need to begin with what you want and the key people what you want and need. You need to begin with what you want and what your key people want and need. And you'll have to understand that the only reason any of us do anything is, what's in it for me? Remember that. The only time anyone does anything ever is, what's in it for me? W-I-I-F-M. Your potential followers have W-I-I-F-M on the brain. W-I-I-F-M. What's in it for me? Don't sell a vision. Sell the benefits of the vision. Remember that. Whoever listens to you has W-I-I-F-M on their forehead. W-I-I-F-M. What's in it for me? Don't sell a vision. Sell the benefits of the vision. John Nesbitt lists a number of benefits people will discover in defining their mutual vision. Here's the benefits you'll find in developing a mutual vision. A strong vision can link a person's job with a person's purpose in life. The office will not be a sleepy place. People will achieve goals more easily. People will experience ownership in the vision. Therefore, they will really know what they and how they could be doing more and why. People will experience ownership of the vision. Therefore, they will really know what they should or could be doing and why. Day-to-day activities will make things really happen. Growth will be focused and therefore easier. There will be a good balance of work and fun. An organization's vision will free people to manage themselves. The key to having happy campers working in your organization is giving your people the chance to grow, both personally and professionally. People beg to make a difference with their lives and add a meaningful contribution. The mutual visions that they state where they're headed gives you people the responsibility for getting organizations to where they want to be. Once a vision is accepted, the responsibility for attaining it is shared. In other words, you're not going to be alone as a leader. For Bill Gore, the founder of Gore-Tex, commitment to vision, not to authority, is what produces results. Commitment to vision, not to authority, is what produces results. Leaders want results, so allow your people to create mutual vision to which they can become committed. A mutual vision gives people a chance to be as good as they think they are. A mutual vision. A leader who can create vision that is meaningful to followers and benefit oriented to them will find people who will be self-motivated to attain the vision, their vision. The leader who creates vision that is meaningful to the followers and benefit oriented to them will find people who will be self-motivated to attain the vision, their vision. And once the mutual vision is accepted, everyone shares the responsibility for attaining it. How do you create a mutual vision? One way for mutual vision is to have a vision quest. As a leader, you select a place away from the office, a normal place of business, then schedule a day where all your key players, so that no one is missing. The days must be labeled as very important. A few weeks later, the vision quest hold brief meeting in which you will define a purpose and vision quest. Set up the day's schedule and you will plan to follow up activities. You must start with the meeting off saying something like this. It's finally dawned on me that maybe not everyone knows where we are going as an organization or trying to go. So you know what we're trying to follow. The path is that we're taking is what we really are, and this is what we're striving for. As your leader, it is my responsibility to help define the direction for you. That's part of my job description. And they say, it goes with the territory. However, I can't get there alone. I do need all of your help shared with where you think and where we should go. What do you see out there and through your own eyes? And what should you like this place to become? What would you like this place to become? Therefore, I've scheduled a day for all of us to explore what we are to become. What's your vision for this organization? Exciting yet realistic picture. Do you see for us the next 3 or 5 years? I've discovered that people have difficulty getting excited about anything further than 5 years. So try to have a vision that's within a 5-year period. With these questions in mind, I'd like each of you to prepare yourselves for how to see us in three from... With each question in mind, I'd like each one of you to prepare your thoughts on how you see us 3 years from now with regards to these areas. Now, each one of these areas in 3 years from now, as far as our gross income, our net income, the number of employees, amount of office manufacturing space, location of offices or plants, market share, what our success will be based on, what we'll have been known for, what position we'll occupy in our industry or the market, what position will we occupy in our industry, why people will want to work here. We will have an outstanding facilitator guideline us through the process of discovering where we are going to each of our areas. Maybe other parameters will surface while we discuss our vision. I realize that I'm responsible for setting a final vision for defining the dream that will benefit all of us. I need your input. I have to be sure that the vision will shape this for this organization is one that we are all excited about and that we will all share responsibility for. We need to define our mutual vision. This vision quest is vital to our company. We're going to decide where we're going. Be ready to do just that. That's kicking off. That's the kickoff meeting. Now reserve a good place, one that's well ventilated and well lit and has plenty of wall surface to pin and tape up a flip chart pages you'll facilitate to the process. Next, select experienced facilitator. Select an experienced facilitator. Find someone who understands the process of its value and who can get people to contribute in a focused manner. It's also important to have a facilitator who can add knowledge and ideas to the process. Then there's to retreat it over. When the retreat is over, you must return to the office and with all the valuable input, distill and define your organization's visions. A former president, Harry Truman so adapted, stated, the buck stops here. He aptly stated the quote, the buck stops here. You are the one who decides. You finally are the one who decides. You must write a crystal clear vision that will be beneficially to the majority of your key people, and the vision will have already convinced that they are excited about it, and obviously one you are excited about. Warren Bennis, proposes a couple ways to choose what your vision will be. Warren Bennis says, number one, your vision could create enthusiastic commitment because it is right for the times, right for the organization, it's right for the people. Your vision could create enthusiastic commitment because it's right for the times, right for the organization, and right for the people. Number two, a crystal clear vision. Number one, it feels right. Number two, it appeals to the gut. Three, it resonates the listener's own emotional needs. And number three, it somehow clicks. I agree with Warren Bennis when he says, leadership ingredients cannot be taught. They must be learned. You have to learn leadership ingredients. One way to learn is really by listening to the people. You will go through the process of creating and defining your mutual values and mutual vision. One way to learn is by really listening to your people as you go through the process of creating and defining your mutual values and mutual visions. People are willing to follow if they are sold on believing what follows in their best interest. Once you have a clear organizational vision, I suggest you meet them again and again on your key players. Present it to them, sell it to them, motivate them to buying into it. Your vision is intangible by itself. You must use emotional benefits to get them to buy in. Emotional benefits that make the vision tangible. One more time. Why have a mutual vision anyway? One more time. The whole reason for creating a vision can be summarized in this story. Two stonecutters were chipping square blocks out of granite. A visitor to the quarry asked what they were doing. The first stonecutter looked rather sore, grumbled, "I'm cutting this damn stone into a block." The second one looked past with his work, replied proudly, I'm one of the team that's building a cathedral. A worker who can envision the whole cathedral as the one who has been given responsibility for constructing a portion of it will be far more satisfied and productive than the worker who sees only the granite. A true leader is the one who designs the cathedral and then shares the vision that inspires others to build it, to give meaning to why you belong to an organization. So, where are we headed is chapter 2. Where are we headed? The checklist. Fact. More people cannot clearly state where the organization is headed. Most people cannot clearly state where the organization is headed. That's a fact. The key to answering is where we headed is line is first answering what's important around here. A vision is important. A mutual vision is the only way to go so that people have a chance to be as good as they think they are. A mutual vision is the only way to go that people can become self-motivated. Once a mutual vision is accepted, everyone shares the responsibility for attaining it. This fact allows you to have a very, very good chance of arriving at your vision, really. People are willing to follow if they are sold on believing that following is in their best interests. They look in the mirror with a smile on their face. Principle 3. Determine your credo. What we stand for. Every leader needs a credo. Every day you'll be talking to people inside and outside your organization. These people need to easily and clearly understand where your firm stands relative to similar firms with which you compete. The listener needs to be able to position your company as a certain kind of company, offering a product or a service with a certain benefits for people with certain needs. Now that you've figured out mutual values and mutual vision, creating a strategy or a plan to get where you want to go is a must, obviously. The key part of the strategy is to get you where you want to go is to answer to, who are we anyway? Who are we anyway? Stated in a crystal clear sentence or a phrase is, who are we anyway? The statement is your credo, your position. I need to clearly differentiate you from the others selling similar products or services. It needs to be a benefit oriented. It needs to address a particular target audience. This credo is what we actually talk about. It's your external rally cry. It's what we say every time we get up to speak. It's what will be what your company's capabilities presentation is based on. It's your credo. It's you. It's what makes you live for. It's what you live for. It's why you exist. It's what you give a sparkle to when you speak. It's what your people must buy into so that they can deliver it. It's what you believe. It's what everyone in your organization must believe. Always. It's your credo. American Mom and Apple Pie Company. Incorporated. The difference between vision and position. Leaders need to talk about where they are headed. What's your vision? Leaders need to talk about what they stand for. What they deliver. Who they are. What's your position? That's your position. Leaders need to talk about where they're headed. That's your vision. Leaders need to talk about what they stand for, what they delivered, and who they are. That's your position. That's what they stand for, and what they stand for, and what they deliver. What you deliver is your position. A vision is where you are going. A position is who you are and your identity. In the reality of business, position is more important than vision. A credo isn't the short line that is essence of a position. And it's what gets talked about to everybody inside or outside of your organization. The credo will institutionalize your vision, and it'll make it a reality. Your credo allows you to be remembered and differentiated. Your vision is essential and internal issue. The financial analysis wants to know it, and does your banker. And you're mostly used only inside to give direction to activities and let your people know the goal or where you're headed. You have to have it in order to create mutual buy-in so that everyone knows where you are as a team headed and as a beneficial to get there on the bus. Why it's beneficial to get on the bus. Your position is largely an external message. It allows the public to know what you do, what you stand for, what's the difference about your product and service, what's the benefit of your product or service, and who you want to do business with. The whole idea of knowing who you are and what you stand for is so simple, yet also so profound and sophisticated. It's difficult to pull off, but once and without it, there's no chance of institutionalizing the vision and make it. There's no chance to institutionalize the vision and make it long-term and lasting. It's difficult to pull off, but without it, there's no chance of institutionalizing the vision to make it long-term and lasting. Your credo is the essence of your position. It's your line. You must have a credo. We're the businessmen airline. For the example, the credo could be is we're the businessmen's airline. I've experienced a beautiful example of a crystal clear position a few years ago when I was doing business in Oslo, Norway. I took a weekend ski trip to a resort 6 hours north of the city to see some beautiful countryside. Speaking to a young Norwegian couple on Saturday night, I asked the young woman, "Who do you work for?" She responds, "SAS, Scandinavian Airlines." "What do you do?" I asked. "I'm a reservationalist." I'm a reservationalist. When I posed a very simple question, tell me about the SAS. SAS? We're the businessman's airline, she said confidently. Somewhat started on her crisp response, I listened to and added in every, in even more self-assured tone, we want everyone to know what we're in the that we're the businessman's airline. Now that's a crystal clear position. Jen Carlson, president of SAS, had a vision. She became the best airline in the world for the frequent business traveler. In his book of Moments of Truth, Carlson states, in order to attain his vision, he and his people decided to position themselves as the businessman's airline. The position gave Carlson a credo from which measured all decisions. He talked about it all to all the people internally, and of course the advertising sales sages focused on the SAS was the businessman's airline. In fact, since the experience in Norway, when a young woman who has a reservation list for SAS clearly sounded off in the company credo, we're the businessman's airline. We're the businessman's airline. I've also checked with many other SAS employees when I fly their airline. Would you believe it? Everyone knows this. In fact, SAS employees get heated and excited when they tell me the benefits of the businessman's airline. Flying SAS, they're sold. They sold me. And by the way, they also helped move SAS as a company to the verge of losing $20 million in 1981 to have just a year later was earning $54 million in 1984. SAS was voted Air Transport World's Airline of the Year. If your organization has a credo now, now you're out talking about it with consistency, and your people will also test as well as the SAS people. And if you don't have a credo, consistent messages to talk about, your people don't know what you stand for. Concentration is the secret. Positioning is essentially the market concept creating to help companies differentiate their products from to the consumer's mind. Positioning is essentially a marketing concept created to help companies differentiate their products in the consumer's mind. For example, if you sell tires, how do your tires differ from the customer benefiting from the other company's tires? It still is a vital rationale for positioning. It's clearly differentiate. How still is it vital rationale for positioning to clearly differentiate? However, I believe that another equal valid rationale for positioning is the principle of concentration. Take the SAS position. We're the businessman's airline. This position allowed or forced all planning, capital, investments, advertising, training, etc. to be measured against one concentrated target. To target to become the world's best airline for the frequent business traveler. In other words, to be the businessman's airline provided a clear, concentrated focus on the SAS could and did attain its vision. The business principle of concentration can be looked at it as this. Concentrating your resources gives you a fighting chance to attain your vision. Down the road, your board of directors or your boss or someone will ask you, well, did we ever get to where you said you wanted to go? Genuine fear can engulf you when your vision has that question. But fear is a legitimate motivator. Since you want to say, of course, we're all on track. We hit the target, and I urge you to create a position so clear that it allows you to concentrate your resources. You have the best moms bake the best pies using the best American apples. The principle of concentrating seems simple, yet it eludes many organizations. So many of us try to do little, but everything tries to please some audiences and never become great at anything. Management, by commitment, fosters this type of thinking, an example for which giving an equal amount of resources to each operating division. This seems fair, but it isn't because, by definition, not all divisions have the same opportunities to get a good return on invested capital. When you see this type of equal distribution of resources, you know that the firm does not understand the principle of concentration. The leader's role is clearly to point out the direction of the organization, then position the organization so that there is a credo to live by. A leader must demand loyalty to the vision and to the credo. Then everyone knows that what you stand for, therefore what your resources must be concentrated towards, so that you have a fighting chance to deliver against your credo. The sequence of activity will automatically create a strong identity to your organization. Concentration is the secret. Organizational identity creates organizational integrity. When you have high integrity, people trust you in what you say you'll do. Without trust, not much happens smoothly. Trust is the emotional glue that binds organizations together. And trust generates more integrity. Integrity requires consistency, and consistency requires focus and concentration. Without focus and concentration, it's almost impossible for your company to be a consistently good one when everything does. It's hard for your company to be consistently good at everything it does. With focus, however, there is a realistic hope that it can be very good at a few things it concentrates on and becomes known for. In these few things that will differentiate your company from others. It is the heart of positioning. That's why we want to have you crystal clear. That's why you want to have a crystal clear position, a crystal clear credo that they talk about, that you talk about. An organization can create high integrity by having a high degree of organizational identity. The organization can create high integrity by having a high degree of organizational identity. You must have trust. Trust is the glue, the integrity to say what you'll do, to do what you say you'll do. Identity yields integrity. Identity yields integrity. From the top of a circle, going clockwise, from the top. Laser clear credo repeated. Credo creates organizational identity. Leader demands loyalty to credo, organization's identity. Concentration of the resources allows validation of credo to customers. The organization and people really deliver against the credo, and consistent delivery allows people to have integrity, to trust themselves and the organization to do what they say they'll do. It loops back into the laser clear credo repeated. When leaders burn into the company credo by continually talking about it internally and externally, organizational identity is created. When people repeatedly hear the credo, we will be and get what we are headed for. They've learned to believe in it. The leader demands loyalty to the position, the company, the credo. And with the position flows the mutual values of the... And when the position flows from mutual values and mutual vision, demanding loyalty to it should be a piece of cake. Now everyone can concentrate on delivering service and products to fulfill the position. Resources are also concentrated where it occurs repeatedly. Customers realize that the organization and the people are demonstrating integrity, that they really deliver what they say they will. That's the secret, to really deliver what you say you will. Trust is generated in these people themselves. Trust is generated in these people themselves. They know how they'll actually do consistent deliver against the credo. They really trust themselves and the organization that they do with when they work with an organization that do what they say they'll do. Now, people feel confident and have pride in the place. They walk around saying their credo with gusto. Now, lots of people repeat the credo. They believe in it. Why? Because they own the credo. It's their credo. By fulfilling the mutual vision will be reached, and you know that they will benefit from that. It all starts with a laser-clear credo that the leader continually talks about. The 30-second elevator ride test. 30 seconds. 2 men in an elevator going up. You see, in the beginning, there was the total darkness. Then... At the top, by the time you get to the top floor, you want to have him going, wow. If you have a laser clear credo that you and your people could talk about, you can pass the test. If you don't, you'll fail it. And lots of other opportunities tell your story succinctly. Here's the 30-second elevator ride test. Imagine getting on an elevator for a ride in your office for 32nd floor, sharing the elevator you just got in with another person, someone you've just nodded to hundreds of other times for but you never talked to. After a comment about the weather and morning traffic, this person says, you know, I see you many times a week, but I've never known or anything about your company. Tell me about your place. You have about 30 seconds before you get off the elevator, and this amount of time you can clearly state, number one, the name of my company, not too tough. Number two, what you stand for and believe in, very tough. Number three, the benefits of your product and service, tough. Try writing these answers in simple questions now for your company, 2 and 3. Most people cannot answer the question in 30 seconds. This means the leadership has not addressed your company and your credo and how that benefits your customers. Every day, hundreds of opportunities present themselves to the people in all levels in the organization. Theoretically, people can at entry level should be able to state the company's credo. Theoretically, people at entry level should be able to know the company and state the company's credo and explain how it's translated into benefits to the customer. You never know when you may be talking to a potential or current customer who needs to boost to the rationale for doing business with you. Everyone needs to be able to talk about these core issues. Number one, who are we? How do we differentiate ourselves from other companies delivering the similar products or services? This is your credo, your position. Number two, how does your credo benefit our customers? Number three, well, actually, as a leader who constantly talks to the credo, we'll discover that almost everyone can recite. A leader who doesn't is missing the mark, losing the chance to turn the entire company into a sales force with a basic selling message. Number one, the credo. Number two, benefits to the customer. Number one is the credo. Number two is benefits to the customer. Try this 30-second test on your employees to discover how clear you've been communicating your own credo. Even if you know how you have a clear credo, find out what your employees say, because they'll say something. It may be far off the mark, but it's still their perception of reality, and to them, that's the truth. You have the right to expect everyone to know your credo and to be loyal to it, but once you have done the work, it makes it laser clear. Your people will love the feeling to get what they can pass in 30-second test. It'll reinforce the why they work there in the organization. It will give them a boost. Plus, they will know they'll be able to visibly talk about who they are. Create Camp Credo. Create a Camp Credo. In order to discover who and when you want to get and where you want to get and where you're headed, you need to attend a Camp Credo. Camp Credo is an off-site, 2-day retreat for your key players in your organization to go to Camp Credo. Only after you have defined your mutual values, you have defined your mutual vision, you can create Camp Credo. Create a simple place with long-tolerant, verbal, mishmash currently spew out. You explain your organization, you realize your new credo so that you have a line of embodies that you are and a line in which you will talk about. you must have a credo to talk about. If you don't have a credo to talk about, it is at this point in your process of leading that many organizations become unglued, deciding what we do best for whom and how can become tangled up with so many hidden agendas, and people's protecting their own organizational turf and the entire process can collapse in a disarray. You must have a credo to talk about. Invariable organizations discover that they don't agree upon what they're good at, and they want to keep doing it, and what they want to keep doing what they want to stop doing. They want to work for, and these kind of clients they'd rather not work for. It's tough to agree, but if you want to lead, you must have a credo. Therefore, what is essential before Camp Credo conveys in the clear underlying understanding of an outcome of the camp. We will decide on the credo, period. We will decide on a credo, period. This is the battle cry before you can camp, because you must have a credo to talk about. You not be able to lead the troops or memorable to your customers. To attain Camp Credo, the key players must prepare to discuss or present the following information in accordance with the suggested agenda. The agenda, number one, is to visualize the key values of your organization has decided to embrace. Make these values clearly understandable to everyone. That is agreement and reached on these followings of what drives us, what makes us tick, whether you can say, yes, that's us, or no, that's not us. What people must understand about is working for us, what they must understand about buying from us, what people must understand about selling to us. How will you clarify these values for all to know that they are permanent, that they are permeant everything you do? Number two, visualize the key points of mutual visions in terms of dollar growth, people growth, facilities growth, new products and services, definition of customers and prospects, mix of business changes, what is major segments of your business to create an income? Will the percentages that each segment delivers change from the current mix? Changes in the market share, major competitors, list the majority indicators and performance you measure to see how the organization is doing. These might include growth, products in depth, price, service, quality, distribution, technology, etc. List all competitors. Create a matrix comparing your organization with the competitors. Rank each company against a major indicator performance over the next 3 to 5 years. Use 1 to 10 scale, with 1 being poor, 10 being very good, and 5 being average. To discover how the picture will look after 3 to 5 years, see what the changes will probably occur. One step yet amazingly effective way to forecast how you and the competitors will grow over the next 3 years is to determine your average annual growth rate than that of each of the competitors. You'll need 4 years of statistics to create a 3-year average compound growth rate. For example, 15% of compounded growth rate per year has doubled in the size of the company in 5 years. Then your simple project, each company's growth over the next 3 years is a historical growth rate. The rationale? More organizations tend to grow in the future at the same time they have in the past. Number seven, research any changes that could have a major effect on your industry, changes that may be brought about by government regulations or deregulations, or environmental concerns, census changes, or new technology. Closely aligned industries, for example, what personal computers did to dedicated word processing machines. Closely aligned industries, for example, what personal computers did to dedicated word processing machines. Competitors changing their market strategy, their mix of products, their distribution systems, etc. Number eight, estimating the likelihood that any of these external changes will happen, and if they do, how will they change the picture and how that you've painted and how the marketplace will probably look in 3 years. Don't get too bogged down with this process. You'll never recover. It may seem like you're playing God, projecting all these things that will happen, but use your combined industries and market sensitivity with your own chutzpah to project like a likelihood of any of these changes happening to your organization 3 years down the road. Number nine. Now summarize where you are. You should be fairly in a good picture of how you see your organization in relation to the competition. You should also gone to the top of the mountain and looked at possible external changes and how you would affect to the picture. Reach a consensus and now to the market will look. You may wish to develop 2 or 3 different scenarios based on external changes. Number 10, now discuss the following questions. Number 1, what do we think our organization does best? What do we think our customers think we do best? How do you think we do benefits and customers the most? What do you do truly differentiates us from the competition and benefits our customers the most? What else do you do truly differentiates the organization and the competition from our employees or our stockholders? Cover the walls with a flip chart, paper chart, and the answers to these questions to confront everyone. Don't forget, if you really do know what your customers perceive to be your strong suit, find out through good research. After all, you want to continue to sell. The customers have clearly defined your major strengths and what is most beneficial to them. Only the customers really know you. Find out what they think and believe. At this point, you might tell a story about certain catering managers of large hotel chain who met and discussed their personal opinions, and they make a good coffee break for people who told and hold meetings in their hotels. They answered that they all agree upon was an outstanding quality of coffee. They have beautiful chinaware, a beautifully packaged coffee service table. Then one of the younger caterer managers said, I'm new here, and I'm new here, but Why don't we ask people who take the coffee breaks, our customers, what they think makes a good coffee break? So they did. Imagine the surprise of finding that the customer's idea of coffee break was fast service. Coffee close to the telephones. Coffee close to the bathrooms. Notice that they never said good quality coffee, beautiful chinaware, beautiful package, coffee service table. Know what your customers want. Fast service, coffee close to the telephones, and coffee close to the bathrooms. A view from a helicopter. Take a bird's eye or view from a helicopter and look down at your company. The next to the last step of Camp Credo employees relates to Ken Blanchard's concept of getting a helicopter view of your situation by hovering over it. By experiencing a facilitator in many of these retreats and joining metaphorical thinking was the helicopter view was a fascinating and a fun exercise. Metaphorical thinking helps you understand the unfamiliar by means of similarities from which this is familiar. This kind of thinking gives us a different slant or problem, and using metaphorical thinking combined with the view of a helicopter, you get an overview with your company with a twist. A twist that will have a truth. A twist that will be clear and clean. A twist that will bring you closer to your credo. To do this, simply ask everyone at the session to review all the information on a flip chart sheet on the walls. If they were, however, over the entire meeting in a helicopter, can you say, it's necessary to start and summarize everything you decide, who you are, what makes us different, and how that benefits our customer. What's your bird's eye view of everything is being said? What's your bird's eye view of everything that's being said? Let them review and make notes about 15 minutes, then hit them with this. And here's a little surprise. Now I want you to take 5 minutes and write an answer to the request. Please explain our company in terms of a fruit. Continue, be honest. You'll get a truth quickly. Be positive. You also point out the areas from which you're not so strong. Creativity is fostered best in the spirit of laughter. So always have creativity exercises through a laughter. I expect to hear some giggles. And now when we're writing, in the next 5 minutes, we'll be around in the room and everyone will read what he or she wrote. Expect to discover truth, who we really are, and how we quickly, metaphorically thinking will free us to explain it. I worked for many organizations as a consultant. This exercise always produces fresh insight and focuses people on the strengths and uniqueness in their organizations. One such experience was to put up with people organization. This 30-year organization has touched millions of people in more than 25 countries, and its message was, people are good everywhere. But explaining up with people is quite difficult, for it is different things in different groups. One thing is to the cast members, something else to the sponsors. By way of background, Up With People is an organization that offers a one-year experiential educational program about 600 college-age students from 25 countries each year. The students learn a musical show. The traveling performs 11 months while living up with hosts and families for 100 different cities, both in America and abroad. My assignment was to help organize an organization explain the prospect sponsors of what is up with people. What is up with people? While working in the sales force, I posed this situation. Put yourself in the shoes of a typical sponsor, for example, vice president of marketing for a bank or a bank's marketing person who has decided to buy a 4-day up with people package for your own town. This cast will come to a town, done their thing, and left. Now explain up with people in terms of a fruit. The sales force has puzzled and began writing, and 5 minutes was up. I was so shocked. What was happening? Who has something? So I asked, who has something? 28-year-old woman stood up and said, speaking as the vice president of a marketing for a bank who had just come to town, well, up with people is like shiny red apple, you see. 8 months ago, when Susan came to our bank and introduced the concept of sponsoring Up With People cast for 4 days, she played a videotape showing all the places and cast had performed. I saw all the bright faces and all the energy reminded me of a bushel of bright, shiny red apples. So we brought in a 4-day sponsorship. Then our cast came to town, the bank employees housed them into the apples and discovered how they tasted a little different. Different backgrounds, cultures, races, interesting, just to each apple tasted different. Yet with the cast performed our logical hospital, nursing homes, every school for the deaf, we discovered that the core of Up With People was the same. People caring about others and caring about one another, caring about common values, all wanting to be better, more peaceful world. When the cast was put into a 2-hour musical show and saw that live on stage 130 shiny red apples sucks such electricity, such energy. As the cast left town, they left seeds and apples so that we could see keep growing in the spirits of people, touching people in a variety of community involvement of programs. Up With People. That's why I say that Up With People was like a shiny red apple. The other salespeople sat with their collective mouths open, somewhat awestruck, and I said, I don't know about you, but if I were selling Up With People next week, I'd walk into a prospective's office and take an apple from my briefcase and say, Mr. Prospect, let me tell you why Up With People is like a shiny red apple. Metaphorical thinking allows people to discover truth, both good and bad. It allows them to express themselves in a memorable way. It is a great exercise to clear away the cobwebs in the brain so that we can discover who we are and create our position, our credo, and what we to be to get to where we want to go. Metaphorical thinking helps you figure out what you will talk about. The magic billboard. I've facilitated many Camp Credos. I've used to call them positioning retreats, and I've learned to call the single best exercise to help discover people, then decide on who they'll be, which their credo is something I call the magic billboard exercise. This says it all. The magic billboard exercise, each person is to use the best computer in the world, the brain, the foster use of the most logical and creative sides of the brain. Each participant must define the essence of what he or she wants to say in effect to have described the credo for the organization. How do you describe the credo? The credo is a strong, crisp, clean statement of what you believe in, which you stand for. Here's how they run the magic billboard exercise. Number one, flip all the chart paper you use in Camp Credo is taped around them to the room, and visual expressions of 2 days in discussion can bombard the brain. So number two, everyone is given 1 hour to write a billboard that explains your company, your credo, on a flip chart. It must be in writing, use of rules for the good outdoor billboards. A, use 6 to 8 words. B, use a visual that can make it easier and clearer if possible. 3, each person outlines the rationale that supports his or her credo. A, why the best way to say you are, why is it the best way to say who you are and what you can become and who you want to arrive at yesterday already agreed upon vision. Why is it the best way to say who you are so you can become who you want to be and arrive at your already agreed upon vision? Each person outlines the rational supports for his or her credo. Why this credo drives and delivers strong benefits to your customer? Why? What will those benefits be? How does the credo stir emotion in the people eternally? What disciplines have you need to improve upon automatically and will automatically improve when the credo becomes your main belief? What will become your battle cry? E, why does your credo seem right for the times? Why does your credo appeal to the gut? Why does your credo seem to be realistic, stretched towards what you will strive to become while you're still being supportable with the rent evidence? Don't forget, you have to be able to say something tomorrow, not just what you'll be able to in 3 years. Remember, don't forget, you have to be able to say something tomorrow, not just what you'll be in 3 years. Number four, now here comes the magic. Each person stands up and prints him or his or her own billboard with the commitment as possible. Each person gives supporting evidence, answering the issues in a point three of this outline. Everyone receives applause at the end of the presentation. High energy time, ideas are valid, no negative comments are allowed. Expect magic, don't be afraid to get excited. Don't forget you've decided to decide. To decide that you've outcome with a definite credo. You all have to decide to decide. We're going to decide, and it's very possible that you'll hit on the right spot. Magic can happen for sure. You'll agree on the essence of the credo, and someone will then go and write it for a final approval. Number six, allow the immediate magic to happen. Even the exact words need to be fine-tuned. All the participants will feel a sense of ownership. Their thumbprints are all over the credo. Therefore, they'll own it, and they'll be committed to supporting it. Now, you will have a very good chance of reaching your vision. America's leading glass fabricator. When the eight top people of Viracom, a division of Uppany Enterprise Incorporated, started out in Camp Credo, none of them realized what a huge discovery they were about to make. All were experienced in glass manufacturing, were marketing professionals. The company was growing substantially and each year and making good money. Jim Martineau, the president of the division, had also been the founder of some years earlier. He built a good team. Things were healthy. Jim and the team were also disciplined in knowledge about the industry. After completing informational matrices, we also got down to what's really differentiating Viracom from the competitors. It may seem strange, but the team discovered the meaning that they didn't know was to walk into the room, that Viracom was the leading glass fabricator in America. That's right, the number one, the leader. Once the team uncovered that Viracom was the leader, they immediately could see some strategies that they could create executive to take advantage of their leadership role in the industry. Their credo, Viracom is America's leading glass fabricator, became the platform for measuring external quality control, distributing products, development, marketing programs, etc. The sales force stood taller. The company's capabilities presentation was more focused and exciting. Viracom is America's leading glass fabricator. The leader and his people now had something to talk about. They have something good to talk about, and they're about it. Step-by-step planning. Grand Forks, North Dakota, and not American hotbed for advertising agencies. Grand Forks. Grand Forks, North Dakota, is not America's hotbed for advertising agencies. However, Simmons Advertising has been in business for there for over 40 years and is strong, well-regarded a regional agency. Fred Lukens, president of Simmons Advertising, used the services to help clean up already existing new business growth plans. The agency was healthy and moving along quite well, and its extraordinary number was very bright. Well-educated people, experienced advertising professionals. After spending the entire day defining the agency's strengths, weaknesses, and goals, I sent all the participants home to create a magic billboard. They were aired, they told, and presented their ideas in flip charts, which then the next morning, after a couple had presented their billboards, Joy, media director, got up, and magic happened. She said, "You know, we all think about good planners, but we're all so good at, but we also plan step by step." She continued, "We always do things in order, not out of sequence. We never let things fall through the cracks of eliminating the shortcuts. We never or eliminate or shortcut to step in the process out of exponentiate out of expediency. Never, we always do the planning step by step. She continued, we always do things in order, not out of sequence. We never let things fall through the cracks or eliminate or shortcut a step in process out of expediency. Never, we always do our planning step by step. She was passionate and evangelistic. She told all of her own peers and her boss. Fred was really excited. So I suggested that we find something that has steps, a step ladder we produced and helps visualize stepping. We discovered that we have seven steps. Simmons' currently planning process has 14 steps. Why not make it a seven-step process? Someone shouted, really shouted, it's too long now, too confusing to everybody. Another person said, yeah, it's engraved. Each of the seven steps is a brass plate, affixes the plate to really a step ladder. Put it in the lobby, a memorable symbol. The credo was born. Step-by-step planning is Simmons advertising. Step-by-step planning. Today, Fred has custom-made, oversized, solid oak step ladders in the lobby, and yes, every step has an engraved plate calling out the specific planning discipline that Simmons following. Fred is the way is 6'8" tall. Fred is, by the way, 6'8" tall. Guess who actually climbs up the ladder with the client of prospects climbing up on the other side during a pitch? Why? To symbolize that both client and the agencies are solidly grounded on a broad platform of information, and both are striving for the same objectives at the top. As you know, the step ladder is broader at the bottom and becomes together at the top. Great symbolism. Simons is a step ladder, pins a desktop model step ladder newsletter called the Step-by-Step Planning. Do you think Fred and all the other people know what to talk about when they explain who Simmons is and how the differentiates itself? Of course, in spades they can explain it. And what do you think grows up in the prospect's home after the pitch before the decision? Guess. What's your credo? What's your vision symbol? Try to top Fred's story. After all, Simmons is only in Grand Forks, North Dakota. So who will we be? So the question is who will we be? Chapter checklist. Until you have a credo, you don't have a core idea to talk about. There's no rally cry, no clear-cut cause to repeat motivate internally and to explain a position to your organization externally. Don't confuse your vision with your position. Your vision is your direction, where you're headed. Your position is what you stand for and deliver. It's your identity. Without your position, you will not institutionalize your vision. A laser clear-cut credo, you have focused direction so that your relative ease, though it'll be with relative ease that you'll go where you're concentrating with your physical, financial, and human resources. However, without a solid concentration of resources, the credo does not live, does not become real. Then all you have is a nice theme line with no substance, no reality, no commitment to the credo. You have to concentrate your resources. When you consistently talk about the credo, you will develop over a period of time a clear organizational identity that will with constant repetition and integrity, people will trust your people and what you promise to deliver. Camp Credo is where the work takes you. In a high energy and incredible team building and exercise is to decide before you go that you'll decide the credo to outcome. The outcome will not be more meetings, they will go on forever. Your credo and the essence of what you'll have is decided to become the goal to where you want to be headed. Visualize your credo everywhere you can. When people open up their personal computers each morning, there it is. The credo and the major benefits to your customer. The credo is the single most important idea that will constantly that your people and you will constantly talk about. Your credo is the single most important idea that you will constantly talk about. Principle 4. Understand the need to fall in love with risk. Falling in love with risk. Risk is the ingredient that gives adventure to my life and wakes me up. Adventure to risk to go together. Risk, my life, gives me the chance to claim victory. And victory means celebration. No risk taken is just another day at the office with unexpected results. At the heart of the visionary is the essence of risk. At the heart of the visionary is the essence of risk. Through risk, we gain a perspective on what means to be alive and try new things to challenge, to accept the possibility of failure as well as success. In my experience, I found that few leaders who want to be a slave to certainty. Leaders find it easy to risk because their commitment to the vision is so strong and so clear to them. It's already theirs. That's why sometimes they don't even see the specific tactic and strategy as too risky. When you create a mutual visions and a foundation for defining mutual visions in a position, you'll discover that everyone will be willing to take risks to attain the mutual vision. In fact, things won't seem very risky. In the final analysis, when a leader ventures out into the road in promised land with a vision and a solid, well-thought-out strategy, the risks are so well-defined that the entire team almost forgets part of the strategy was based on some risky assumptions or projections. When everything runs as plans, they look at the leader as a visionary. When things don't go well, they call the leader a foolish risk taker. The essence of risk lies at the heart of every leader. Webster says risk in a negative concept. There's some real irony in Webster's definition of risk, which explains it in a negative terms only. Risk, a chance of injury, damage or loss, dangerous chance, hazard in insurance, the chance of loss, the degree of probability of loss, an amount of possible loss to an insuring company, the risk of insuring, taking a chance. Amazing, all downers. No wonder most people don't like to do risk and they look downright at risk and have a fear. We've been taught that even by Webster. This is why I believe in the mandatory of a leader to weigh not in the hazards and the opposites affording by risk, but what's going on the other sides of hazards or loss, but seems to they got their good news and gains and successes and contributions and victories. Unfortunately, those who do not learn to love to risk close the door to leadership. The potential negative outcome simply seems too large to hurdle and tackle, and doesn't help when most employees nod their collective heads and say, it's too risky, we'd better stay where we are. The leader weighs the opportunities afforded by risk. I'm in love with risk. Be in love with risk. We know the waters too well to venture into an unknown territory. Let's stay put. Leaders who have to understand risk and have to understand the nature of risk have to look at all sides of the issue and the positive and the negatives, and then they have to have a better chance of convincing potential followers why they should risk. An idea that isn't risky is hardly worth calling an idea. An idea has to be risky. Almost everyone agrees that gustos of the things are more competitive than they used to be, and they bet that the facts creates the necessary for new ideas to be not just a little off-center, but substantially different. Really different. So that there is a new clear competitive difference and a reason to do business with you. Therefore, by definition, ideas in today's business climate have to be risky in order to change, and to cause change, then that's substantive. And the proposed idea is to cause only minimum change in direction, policy, service, etc. Well, the troops that probably have found those within you, they don't really need your leadership to make the change. They'd stumble into the minor changes by themselves. Remember, an idea that isn't risky is hardly worth calling an idea. New and really different road, or the same old road. The choice is yours. In the fork of the road, a new and really different road, or the same old road. Leaders need to be on the cutting edge, and risky ideas can march their people into the new ideas and ways of doing things. Ideas are not risky enough. Ideas that are not risky enough are not worth talking about. Why risk? Change is necessary for staying alive. Change is necessary for being current. Change is necessary for growing healthy. Change in today's byword. Change is today's byword. Like it or not, the world is changing faster than ever, and if you want to stay on it, you have to change with change. However, everyone knows that change is good for something but me, so attitude is the powerful when you want to change and make something happen. I see two major reasons to risk, to change and it's stimulating. I love risk because of change and it's stimulating. You're going to need a lot of ammunition to answer this question. Why change? Which I believe in the same question of why risk? Risk necessitates change, and most people most of their time directly relate change to risk. They want things to stay as they are. Since they're strongly suggested in a new vision, the new strategy for getting there, obviously some changes are going to have to take place. Ergo, risks must be taken to cause change. Change risks take to the cornerstone of all leadership. Change and risk taking is the cornerstone of all leadership. To change and risk taking is the cornerstone of all leadership. Leaders thrive on it emotionally and illogically. John Akers, IBM former chair, has said that we change our organization structure every 5 years just to change. It keeps our troops fresh. Nothing gets stale. Peter Drucker is one of the earliest books, Managing for Results, feels. If you're still doing the same thing 5 years from now and still be outmodeled, you will be outmodeled by the competition and you will be outpaced. If you're doing the same things today that you did 5 years ago, you will be outpaced and replaced. Mark Twain believed loyalty to petrified opinion must be broken. A leader's job is not to do just that. Break the logjam of petrified opinion. Why risk? Because your commitment to the vision is burning within you. Why risk? Because it's stimulating to think and act and live that way. Why risk? Because unless you're willing to take risks, you will suffer paralyzing inhibitions. Why risk? Because if you don't, you will never do what you are capable of doing. Too many people do what you're supposed to do, not what they want to do, because the risk seems unbearable. In fact, my experience with organizations has proven without a shadow of doubt that there is no such thing as leadership without risk. There is no such thing as leadership without risk, and risk does not make leading difficult. Risk makes leading worthwhile. How to make risk less risky and more fun? Risks are taken in the context of the correct set balance values. When the vision and value statements in an organization are prepared by, for, and by its key players, therefore you risk takes that are considered by all their best interests. Reach their vision, not just yours. Now you have some wide risks being taken, and the risks seem less risky. The concept goes to the heart of empowering others to risk. The leader empowers people to pulls rather than to attract, the energizing people to vision to the future. And the leader motivates by identifying with the vision, by aligning following with it, not by rewarding the punishment. Everyone is given the green light to take risks in order to attain vision because everyone is so committed to success of the quest. My theory is to reward risk, not just to tell people risk. Set up some system of reinforcing, trying, risking, failing, to Tom Watson of IBM said, if you want to succeed, double your failure rate. Put another way, if you haven't failed, you haven't tried very hard. It's a constant process, trying, risking, winning some, losing some. That's the game. To constantly, constant process of trying, risking, winning some, losing some. That's the game. A second reason leaders risk is because it's stimulating. All of us will be the same 5 years from now, with the same exception of books we read. All of us will be the same from 5 years from now, in exception of the books we read, the people we meet, the places we go, and the risks that we take. Leaders want to be different 5 years from now down the road. Leaders view life as driving. Sometimes they're forward of gears. Sometimes it's reverse. Although it's not intentionally, there is never a neutral. Every fresh idea I encounter, each person I meet or place, travel or risk, likes I take makes me feel more alive. Leaders celebrate victories and learn from their defeats. How dull life would be without celebrations and without some experiential forcing learning, the kind our mothers were talking about when they said, this is good for you. Swinging from the heels from Reggie Jackson's illustrious high-paid career in baseball, Mr. October risking big, he also struck out a lot. Most leaders are attackers, not defenders. Attacking is stimulating, requires tons of homework and due diligence. The sweat you are about, you are an offensive. The best defense is a good offense. The best defense is a good offense. Leaders can never get too excited about playing defense. It's boring and produces no great press clippings in the trade press. Brooke Knapp. Brooke Knapp said that there are two kinds of people, those who are paralyzed by fear and those who are afraid, but go ahead anyway. The great Carl Willenda, the famous tightrope walker, said, being on the tightrope is living. Everything else is just waiting. She finally stood up to speak. Learning to be a better presenter involves risk. The reasons are obvious and visible. You are on the plate and you are doing something between hitting a grand slam and striking out with the bases loaded. I teach you, if you want to be a better presenter, you will need to do some things that are physically different from what you are currently doing. Physically different. Here's a beautiful story involving a physical change and an obvious risk a woman took in disregarding the cultural practice inside her banking organization. I was training a group for senior managers at a large Midwestern bank. One of the women said that she could not maintain good control of her audience while presenting. Also, she did not feel her message was delivering with much authority. I asked you, well, what do you do? Well, I sit in the middle of my conference table and about 12 people, and through my presentation I said, why don't you stand up in a variety of visual aids and add more impact to your presentation? She looked at me with astonishment as if I had a naughty word. Well, you don't understand, at our banks we don't stand up in these meetings. I added a number of additions of ways of standing up should solve her control and authority problem. She interrupted me. I said, we don't stand at our bank. 1 month later, I received a critique from our actual presentation she had given. She said that she used some of my ideas to gain and control and improve authority, and she also stood up to give the presentation. Her boss told afterwards, that's the best presentation I've ever seen in this room. She took a risk. She stood up. It was a very big day for her. Plus, she showed others how to do something different to make a difference. The key to happiness. While writing Passages, her extraordinary popular book on the stages of adult life, author Gail Sheehy came across an incredible lucky group of people. She called them people of high well-being, and they made her intensely curious. How, she asked, had they achieved such a state of fulfillment and happiness? Sheehy was really asking the question, what is the key to happiness? Sheehy's happy people were beautiful and homely, were very bright and so-so, and so her life spending more and more she could save. In fact, they were more different than alike. But he ultimately discovered that these people had seven things in common. One of the seven things happy people shared was this. They had all taken a very significant risks in their lives, faced with the choice between taking safe walks or scaleless Everest, which have chosen ice axes or heavy jackets. Some had fallen, but gotten back up and climbed. Some had fallen again and over again and had tried, and from that, they had been rewarded. It's only by risking that you really can live it all. Someone once wrote, and the evidence for all this is all around us. They all had taken a very significant risk in their lives. In reading Sheehy's thorough evidence that will become convinced that will in reading Sheehy's thorough evidence, you will become convinced that not only taking risks necessary for leadership in business, taking risks is necessary for the soul. I personally discovered the following. Overcoming a little danger in my life builds confidence. For example, downhill skiing always makes me risk. Through risk, I gain perspective of what means to be alive, to try new things, to challenge, to accept the possibility of failure as well as success. When I risk, there are victories and there are defeats. Celebrations follow victories. Learning follows defeats. Risk gives adventure to my life. It's not a sleepy existence. Risk wakes me up. The ability to risk is the quality to model, to pass on to my family as well as those whom I work with. Why flirting with failure almost always gets success's attention? Always do what you are afraid to do. Well, for all Emerson. It is easy to see why so many risks work. Americans love underdogs. It's a fundamental American trait. So why do you take the risk of this country? Thousands of people root for you, and many end up helping you. In short, the mere fact the risk of help enhances your chance of succeeding. A risk so is unexpected, so it catches your competition unprepared. Just like the likely vision of a risk energizes your people, they see in your vision both great rewards. If they succeed heavily, penalties if they fail. Choosing risk visions then puts both stick and a carrot to work for you. A risky vision also more likely to energize your people because it is new. As a very advertiser, new is one of the most appealing words in our language. New, new, new. A new vision appeals to basic human needs for novelty. It conforms to life is not as the author as the infamous bumper sticker suggests, just one damn thing after another. It's not. Things are new. Imagine the reverse of a safe vision. Why make a vision safe? The fact is it's been attempted before and it succeeded, but the fact that something has done before as evidence is that it will not succeed again because its marketing terms and niche already has been filled. Where there's more riskiness, the adventure into the unknown, to borrow again from the wisdom of great advertisers, the legendary Bill Birnbach said, safe advertising is the riskiest advertising of all. Safe visions are risky too. Safe visions are not for you. You want to have unsafe, unthought of, unsecured visions, risking yourself. You're nobody until somebody hates you. Ever a once rich with a promise company, Minneapolis, presides Jay Wilson, an executive who lives to be liked. To potential followers to appear, he's consistently cordial, flattering, and positive. Naturally, these people initially think that Jay is very nice, but eventually decides otherwise. They realize that Jay is usually not nice to his people. He just wants them to think that he's wonderful. Eventually, everyone catches up to Jay's act, and many people start hating him for it. As a result, lacking for the benefits to come up with honest leadership and respect of criticism, his company has stalled. Jay has failed to realize the nicest thing you can be is the... Jay's failed to realize the nicest thing you can be with people isn't nice. It's honest. People don't want Du Bois praise and foreign support. They want you to know where they stand, how they're doing, the future that they have with your company. I've dubbed this, not really that nice after all, leadership style in Gerald Ford syndrome. Once of the recent American presidents, not had more friends than Ford. All of the recent American presidents, none had more friends than Ford. None said as many nice things to many people. None earned as many invitations to pro-am golf tournaments. I have changed this person's name to protect his anonymity. For Ford's apparent niceness didn't earn him, however, was true followers. Almost everyone liked Ford, but virtually no one was willing to vote for him in 1976. Ford was not a leader. Don't communicate nicely. Communicate honestly, tactfully, and respectfully. Again, don't communicate nicely. Communicate honestly, tactfully, and respectfully in a way that earns your people's permanent respect instead of their temporary affection. Communication openly and honestly may seem like a risk, but it certainly feels like a risk, but it's risk leaders must take. Vince Lombardi didn't win 3 Super Bowls by congratulating his linebackers on missed tackles. You have to communicate honestly, tactfully, and respectfully. How do you risk? First, you get committed. Then it's easy. Everyone following you will share the vision and the values of your organization. Everyone will embrace the risk as a part of a design of the strategy. As a leader, as an absolute necessity, you demand loyalty and vision to the strategy. Obviously, only it's always impossible to demand that someone shares your organizational values. When you have clearly defined your visions, values, and strategy captured your company's credo, people who are not in agreement with this will leave on their own. If they don't leave, they continue to torpedo your efforts, you should show them the door. You risk by not having total agreement on what you're going to, and the basic rule to intend the travel is to get there. Without agreement with the vision, no one will accept even the smallest risks, even the slightest change with the current practice. With agreement, risk-taking is a natural course of action, a necessary course of definition. So how do you risk? First, you get agreement on the values and vision, then go outside of the square. All in favor, say yes. One of the oldest puzzles teaches you how to look at problems in a different light than the one below. Connect all the dots with your straight lines while never taking your pencil off the paper. People usually can't do it. What they do often looks like this. Notice that they never go outside the imaginary lines of the square created by the 9 dots. They simply stay inside the parameters through the attempt to solve the problem. They don't venture out into the new territory. They don't even risk. Ergo, problems can't be solved. The solution to the 9-dot problem could go outside the imaginary lines of the square. When I was 30, I had a mentor who taught me the way of this, thinking he said, Bob, for the rest of your life, from this point out, every time that you have a problem that's large enough to require alterization solutions, make sure one of the alternatives is outside of the square. Before you select the best one, make sure there's an alternative that stretches your mind to make sure that there's a better and best idea, one that you'll choose. I want you to look outside of your head and at least once a month, see how many stretched marks there are out of your brain. And he meant it, and so I did, and so do I. This principle, the single best guidance light to test whether or not it really taking risk. Always make sure that there's a good share of your alternatives are outside of the square. By the law of averages, some of the risky ideas will be good and worth trying. And if you're risky, you're doing outside the normal way of looking in the situation. When you go outside of the lines, it's scary, it's lonely, it's risky, it's new territory. This poem, Coloring, by Sarah Maney, further explains what I'm talking about. Coloring. Coloring outside of the lines is scary business. Some days I don't have the courage for it all. On my big bold days, though, I let my red crayon just streak across the line. Then I swirl my purple and orange out there with a perfect freedom, no lines. Coloring outside the lines is lonely, too. I'm the only one who doesn't get a gold star on my paper. The teacher frowns. The kids call me weird or dumb or retarded. Why don't they see that I'm not behind them? I'm not in front of them, running free outside of the lines. It would be nice to have friends who colored outside of the lines sometimes, too. Wouldn't you? In coloring. Several years ago, like Mike Vance, who speaks of creativity on The Engineer in a session, was facilitating an attack of nine-dot puzzle with zeal. He solved it, then said, Mr. Vance, I found the problem, and I've selected a solution which outside the square. Next time there's a problem, it comes up again. Should I go for further outlines, the lines? Vance said, you got it. You could see that the squares are now bigger and that you must go out even further to risk again. During the many comps credos I facilitated, there has been a consistent discovery. Most organizations do not seem to have any systems for generating ideas. You have to have a system for generating ideas. Ideas can as well as be outside of the square. Too many business people do not think of themselves as creative. For the born of the gift of creativity, it seems to be taught not only to use like phrases, or it's too radical, it's contrary to policy, or it won't work in our industry, or you can guarantee that that won't work. It worries our lawyers. It would be impractical. We can never market that. We don't have no time. From Roger Von Oeck, the whack on the side of the head. A whack on the side of the head. You need to be against being too radical, against the contrary to policy, against the work in the industry, against it's not going to work, against that it worries people, against that it's impractical, against that it'll never work in the market, against that you don't have time. You're going to make it happen. The main issue is to be addressed when linking creativity to risk is this. You can learn to be more creative. Learn to come up with more ideas and help develop your strategies. Many brainstorming techniques can be systematically used to help generate the options and insight. More alternatives usually help lower the risk level. I believe that the applied creativity with one of Mitch's techniques of the future, it would allow companies to make major advances toward their aggressive visions because they have a risk of creating more options to select one from the form of doing the things, of doing right things, not just doing things right. Doing the right things, not just doing things right. You have to do the right things. At the very heart of even visionary, the essence of risk, being able to see the future is better and somehow different carries itself with an ability to risk. One of the most touching things that I've ever happened to me involves the nine-dot square. The nine-dot square is three dots, 1, 2, 3, three under them, 1, 2, 3, and three under them, 1, 2, 3. That's the nine-dot square. To find out how you can connect the dots. My client in the story was once again us with people. My client in this story was again up with people. One of my sessions I held in the cast members focused on a goal setting and its importance of showing each cast member how he can and she could be responsible for maximizing their year up with people. During a session, I facilitated the cast members writing of two types of goals. Realistic goals inside the square. Risk or stretch goals outside the square. Realistic goals need to be touchable to have a good chance of happening. Risk goals are created only by going outside of the square. I show the cast members the nine-dot square and explain the concept of going outside the square to risk. These goals are truly stretch goals, the kind to have a sweet little to reach. As Leo Burnett, the legendary advertising world, said, reach for the stars and you won't come up with a handful of mud. By the way, you should see their eyes light up when you start writing the stretch goals. They get excited by going outside of the square risk to better than expected to really push for some growth. The experience that truly touched my happiness was in 1988 when I was working in Oslo, Norway. I discovered it up with a people cast performing in Copenhagen and Tiviola Gardens. It was the same cast I'd spoken with about goal setting in November 1987. And so I flew to Copenhagen to surprise the cast and see them perform. When I arrived, the surprise was over. One of the cast members came up to me and said, Mr. Boylan, I want to tell you that you have literally changed my approach to living. It's the most significant thing I've ever taught me, you have ever taught me, and I have ever been taught, and that you had taught me. What is it? I responded. Let me show you, she said. She opened the purse, took out a pen, took back to me, and seemed to be in writing. She turned out she held up a palm on her left hand. She had written down the felt pen of the three dots. The nine dot mental exercise to think out of the box. square. Thanks. We both started to cry. By the way, that's the real pay a consultant receives, making a difference in a person's life. The most important pay a consultant receives is making a difference in a person's life. How do we risk? We get committed, take a long shot, and go outside of the square. So why risk? Chapter checklist. Risk is the core of leadership. Without embracing it, without falling in love with risk, you simply will never voice your vision. You'll keep it inside. You need to be responsible for accepting risk, and the only way you'll ever substantiate to move toward reaching your vision of a better condition, risk puts pizzazz in your life, gives you the zest, zing, vitality, and the reason you can celebrate victory. If there's no risk, there's no real celebration. People accept risk in order to change. Change is synonymous with risk. Change is mandatory to improving conditions. You get your visions out of the future. You accept your own risks for two reasons. Your commitment to the vision is so intense that you'll move mountains to reach it. You'll do what has to be done before you quest reaching the vision. You'll preserve it. Risk is stimulating. It teaches. It keeps you fresh, provocative, ahead of the pack. Leading, it seems to be a part of what makes you up. It's actually fun. The only way that you risk is to get committed to a vision. If you're not really committed, you'll find that the strategies given in the vision will be lukewarm, not risky, but big enough to probably ever get the vision. Change requires risk. The old Chinese proverb says, it's very difficult to leap a large chasm in two bounds. The only way that you will risk is to get committed to a vision. If you're not really committed, you'll find that the strategies to reach the vision will be lukewarm and not risky, not big enough to probably ever get the vision. Change requires risk. An old Chinese proverb says, it's very difficult to leap a large chasm in two bounds. Principle 5, learn to motivate people. Listen up and listen good. You've got to be able to motivate people. How you attract and motivate people determines your success as a leader. You can follow the first 4 steps and still fail. For over half of my professional life, I've been teaching middle and senior managers of corporations how to improve their presentation skills, how to be better on their feet. And remember, you can't lead with memos. There's a wide difference between person's competence and effectiveness based on the person's ability to communicate verbally. We are not paid just for our competence. We are paid to be effective, and the effectiveness is usually measured by our productivity, our ability to get people to follow us so that more people are working on the right things. The sad reality is that there are some bright folks out there who haven't followed the first 4 ideas of what we talked about, but still get anybody to follow them because they can't motivate people to act, to move, to do it. The bad news is that there's a lot of folks out there in this spot, either that they don't have the skills to motivate or fear stops them from getting things in their feet and saying, here's what we should do to let's go. Nothing such happens. Frustration reigns. Nothing changes. There's no visible defeat from trying, and there's no celebration of victory. The bad news is the skills of these folks in either spot, they don't have the skills to motivate. Fear stops them from getting on their feet and saying, all right, here's what we should go. Let's go. Here's where we should go. Let's go. And the good news is that the skills can be learned. There's not an inbred availability on those few who have been touched with God. Once you create a mutual set of values and mutual visions, you allow your self-motivation. Your motivational skills don't have to be evangelistic in quality. Warren Bennis says, leaders have no interest in proving themselves. They have an abiding interest in expressing themselves. To be successful in motivating others, you need skills to be able to express yourself. What are we selling? To begin with, a leader cannot mandate a vision to impose it on a potential followers. Like any other product or vision is something you must sell. Remember, WIIFM, what's in it for me? You cannot assume that everyone will just buy into your vision and position when they've been created jointly. You need to lead people, and to them, for them to follow is talking about 4 areas we previously discussed. Potential followers have WIIM tattooed on their foreheads. WIIFM, what's in it for me? The only thing that are really interested is the answer to the question is, what's in it for me? Since the potential followers have WIIFM on their brain, don't sell a vision, sell the benefits of the vision. Too often the leader spouts off about how big they're going to be in 3 years. We'll be leading in a brand, accelerating the growth. We'll have a new plan if you hit our sales targets, etc. And the people reply, that's nice, but so, what's in it for me? Don't assume that growth, more plants, and more people and benefiting market share are automatically the thoughts of good things for other people. The savvy leaders learn the skills needed to be an effective motivator, an effective presenter, and an effective salesperson. One of the keys is to understand what's your vision is intangible by itself. To understand that your vision is intangible by itself, you must use emotional benefits to get the buy-in. Emotional benefits get the buy-in. The secret to getting the buy-in is having emotional benefits. Benefits come from 2 forms, logical and emotional. Emotional benefits are much more powerful. Emotional benefits, logical benefits are like money, time, productivity, efficiency, safety. Logical benefits are like money and time and productivity, efficiency, and safety. But emotional benefits is recognition or security or pleasure or achievement. Emotional benefits is recognition, security, pleasure, and achievement. Leaders won't work with emotional resources. Therefore, you need to learn to talk about emotional benefits in order to tap the emotional resources in your organization. There, once you have defined the emotional benefits of the vision to all your troops, the vision will become tangible. By the way of emotional resources, your people are the most powerful resources any organization has. Your people. It's so clear. Emotional benefits will make the vision tangible. People are willing to follow if you've made them believe their following is in their best interests. The only way to motivate, without a careful and construction vision with all benefit all, it is basically impossible to motivate people to act. They don't have a clear picture of what's in it for me. Therefore, it is the vision to inconceived, and the vision is ill-conceived and felt to be yours and yours alone. You only have two ways to motivate, fear and intimidation. You can order people to act, but this process is the acting many companies every day in places they are fun to work, but people there don't try very hard to excel or to be as productive as they possibly can because they don't have any understanding of what they're headed for, where they're headed. They have no vision, and that's of nothing that's exciting to them. They have no vision that's exciting to them. So you've got a glum bunch of people, and every day how you got to motivate them is get more and get more done faster by better quality, because the values at the bottom is what needs to be understood to lead up to the visions, to climb up again to the credo of what we do, our catch statement, how we are and what we're known for. And then the top is success. If you don't, the story goes the leadership's by pushing is not pulling. Leadership lead by pushing, not pulling. The best way to motivate is to get people to act towards something that which the vested interest. And vested interest is no motivation. Leadership is pulling. Leadership by pulling requires building long-term trust in where your organization is going, what it will be and stand in order to get there. Again, leadership by pushing, not pulling. The values on the grounds or rules are which everyone must play. When there's three ingredients of leadership, which is where's the organization going, what it will be and stand for in order to get there, and the values or the ground rules from which everyone must play. When these three ingredients of leadership are clearly defined, all to understand the benefit from, and only have created the climate to motivate people to act, the accept risk is to change, and you're able to pull them with you, and they're able and they're now following. With your vision to become reality, it must be their vision too. The only way to motivate people ever to a long haul is to sell the benefits of your vision. Why motivate? As you can see, you have to motivate people to help you get them to where they want to go, to where you want them to go, and where you want to go, to realize your vision of the future. Today's business world talks about empowering people to act with the proper climate, possible empowerment, people to act, see themselves as they act in their own behalf. To motivate and create a momentum, there's a concept mass requires the most difference. Once you attain certain mass, things happen, but mass doesn't just happen. A leader motivates and orchestrates proposed activity. Leaders are paid to set the direction, establish the plan, motivate the troops to join the team, shoot to reach the goal so that others will help you get to where you want to go. In fact, bottom line task of leaders to motivate others to follow. If no one follows, nothing happens. The bottom line is to get them to act. Why motivate? To create an energized attitude. Clayton Barbeau, a counseling psychologist from San Francisco, says that there are basically two kinds of folks: energy givers and energy suckers. We believe we all fall in one of the categories or the others. I believe him. My own experience is getting people to follow forces me to energize, to be an energy giver. I can never follow people, and when I'm a glum, bitter, angry, or tired, they just raise their hands and say, sure, I'll go along with you. Why should they? I've been bought the idea myself. When would we think motivators? But when we think of motivators, people like Zig Ziglar and other well-known professional speakers come to mind. They're called motivational speakers. They're people with good money and good hair. The people that we pay good money to hear them, and this must be the wink that we can motivate if only the right person with the right message tells us what to do. I'm a professional speaker myself, and when I tell people that, many times I immediately ask, oh, so are you one of those motivational guys? I always said, I hope so, not just to get so hyped up, but to get them to do something they have invested in and they have vested interest in. I've always hoped so, not just to get people hyped up, but to get them to go do something they have a vested interest in. Do something you have a vested interest in a summary. What's a motivation? Getting people excited so they act in a focused direction. Motivation is to get someone or something to act in a certain direction, in a focused direction. You are trying to move people in a specific direction, not just move them so that they feel better. You've got to be able to tell your story. Read what Jan Carlson, CEO of SAS, says in his book of Moments of Truth. about taking the responsibility to motivate the values he places in communicating effectively. Number one, we can order our employees to do things differently. Instead, we have to convey our vision to the company and convince them that they could and should take responsibility for carrying out that vision. Number two, a good leader spends more time communicating than doing anything else. Communicating with employees keeps them all working towards the same goal, and with his customers to keep them abreast of the company's new activities and services. From my first day of SAS, I have made communications our top priority. Half of my working hours is communicating. We've considered the words a receiver can be absorbed, and they can make them their own. And in such things, an oversimplified phrase after a speech often tell me, that was a phenomenal way to getting across an obvious points. I'm not always certain whether you mean it as a compliment, but maybe they're not just certain either. But I believe that I have successfully conveyed my message from what has come across obvious. It means they found my way to express something that strikes a resonant chord inside of a person, inside of people who are listening to me. I have reached them. There's no question that this kind of leadership communication I'm calling involves more than a little showmanship. If you want to be an effective leader, you cannot shy or be reticent. Knowing what to appear before large audiences and persuade them to buy your message is a crucial attribute of leadership, almost as crucial as being able to calculate or plan. Unless you can communicate your business strategy clearly to your customers, you might as well have developed it at all. You might as well not have developed it at all unless you can communicate your business strategy clearly to your customers. Even hear some complain, he was just too darn clear. He was just too darn clear. Of course not. Did you ever hear somebody complain, man, he was just too darn clear? Your goal is to persuade people, not to show them you know more than they do. It's to persuade them. Leaders must tell a laser-clear story. Repeatedly, a laser-clear story. Pretty heavy stuff. No communication skills, no actualization of the plan. Why have a vision at all if you can't get people to follow you? If you're excited, notify your face. Telling your face clearly is one thing. Telling it so it looks as if you bought into yourself is another. How many times you're witnessing someone giving a presentation about something he or she is saying is important, and we've seen a person start off well, but in a few minutes reverted to predictable, monotone, flat-faced, dull-sounding company lines. I have one simple rule about going to be out there telling your story so that people will follow you. If it looks as if you haven't bought your own idea, why should anyone else? If you're excited, notify your face. Your face is your most important visual aid. It makes sure that you have a natural intent of your vision. You should be helped to dream it up. You should show it and people won't follow you. Now just show it or people won't follow you. There's always a story about a TV newscaster interviewing the devil. What's the greatest weapon you use with the people? Is it lies, jealousy, hate? No, the most successful tools I use is indifference, as I make people not care. Make your vision a cause. Most of us have noticed the zeal and fervor of people who work in a nonprofit organization. They are usually on fire about their cause. Never have this brought home to be more clearly. And when I participate in two annual symposia in Windstar Foundation, Aspen, Colorado, 1,800 people gather in Aspen festivals, music festivals, for about 4 days. Two-thirds of those are attending work for the nonprofit organizations. As the conference started in tackling the hard issues of pollution, the people from work forming together in various nonprofits were downright passionate about their beliefs and what they were doing. I instruct my nonprofit-oriented clients to define a vision that they think of as a cause. A normal corporate financial goal that does not close to igniting the same natural energies can burn inside of you when you have a cause. The cause makes you catch on fire. Most people need to lead through their voice, not through their position. When they have a vision, they now can see it as a cause. Your voice is naturally more passionate. It changes as a pace and a tone to sound excited. You sound excited and you look excited. What's happening is that you're looking and sounding committed, and until you do, no one else will follow you. Make your vision a clause. A vision that can cause allows you to be naturally committed. A vision that is a cause allows you to be naturally committed. Enthusiasm is catching. Passion is infectious. As a presentation skills trainer, I know that you need two ingredients. Two ingredients for going to where you're talking to others is trying to get them to follow you is to enthusiasm and passionate speaking. And number one is your clarity. Number two is caring. The two number one ingredients when it comes to speaking with people and when it comes to dealing with other people you're talking to. Number one is clarity. Two is caring. Clarity. When you've developed a crystal clear vision and position, you should naturally be clear. Clarity allows you to be focused with energy when you speak. Clarity allows you to be remembered so when you can be evaluated. Caring. Caring, since the creating of the vision of position based on discovering what's important around here, you platformed your thinking on mutual values. Mutual values led to a mutual vision and a position. Mutual values led to a mutual vision and a position. This will naturally allow you to speak about the emotional benefits of a joint vision. You will demonstrate natural caring to your listeners. They will like you. They will trust you. They will follow you. And you will demonstrate natural caring to your listeners. And they will like you. They will trust you. And they will follow you. Great leaders are like committed to their visions. It becomes their cause. To summarize, a good vision makes you passionate and compelled to make it happen. Leaders are shamelessly enthusiastic about their vision. Laser clarity communicates that you care and you demonstrate natural commitment. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. You gotta make your vision a cause. When you talk, you gotta be naturally committed. People will follow you, so learn to motivate. Chapter checklist. Being good on your feet is a must. But it isn't enough to be competent. You need to be able to communicate your competence or you're not effective. Sell the benefits of the vision, especially the emotional benefits. You need to discover what your people could have vested in the interest. This is much easier to motivate them. In fact, it's the only way to motivate them. You need to discover what your people could have vested interest in. It's mandatory to motivate others so they help you get to the promised land. Plus, it's a lot of more fun to work in a place where there's energy ambience is high. Getting people excited so that they act in a focused direction is the trick. Not just getting them excited, getting them to act in a focused direction. Telling your story a lot is the territory of the leader. Skills are needed so that you don't appear to on your deathbed while presenting. Skills are needed so you don't appear to be on your deathbed while presenting. How you look and sound actually does more establish trust and believability in the listeners than words you speak. You may have a quick check to make sure you notify your face and you're excited. Think of your credo as a cause. It will make you naturally more intense, more committed, more clear, and more caring. Think about it as a cause. Conclusion. Now what do I do? Leadership shoes. Put on your leadership shoes. That's all very interesting, but what's next? Peters and Waterman, in their book, The Search for Excellence, feels that one trait excellence companies have in common, their propensity to act. The ready, fire, aim concept. It's the ready, fire, aim concept. Nike tennis shoes and shout out, just do it. The promise I've tried is simply ways you need to do it alone. It's just talk to that people follow you. Also, just to spend time and to deal with your time communicating, telling your story, getting skilled at telling your story. I've tried to follow Albert Einstein's rule. If you can't say it simply, you probably don't have anything to say. And if you can't say it simply, you don't know your subject. So I've listed 20 steps to go, 20 steps that will help you become a skilled motivator. I urge you to act these steps to lead, to make a difference, to discover yourself and others of why you really want to go and where you really want to go and what kind of place you wanted to work in because about which you can and want to work in and the cause about which you can get excited about. Put on your leadership shoes and set out and run with the tracks. Leave footprints behind you. 20 steps to do. 20 steps to do. Discover your own values. What's important to you? Number one, discover your own values. What's important to you? Number two, discover what direction lights a fire under you. What can become a cause? Number two, discover what direction lights a fire under you and what can become a cause. Number three, define what you believe to be benefits to each of your key players. The people you want to have following you, define what you believe to be benefits to each of your key players and the people you want to have following you. Number four, discover what their key values are. What's important around here? Number four, discover their key values and what's important around here. Number five, hold a vision. Discover where your people want to go. What turns them on? Number six, define a mutual vision based on shared values. Number seven, develop a list of logical emotional benefits that make the vision a sellable product to all of your people. Make a list of the emotional benefits. Number eight, present the mutual visions of your benefits to key people. Get agreement. Now you can have mutual vision. Shared values is it's based on. Benefits for all to become committed to it. Number nine, create a camp credo with key people. Define who you'll be attain your vision. Define who you'll be to attain your vision. Define your credo. Flesh out the strategies and tactics to execute the plan to attain the vision. Agree on the plan. Number 10, realize the risk has to become a part of your vision and plan. Risk will seem natural because it's taken in the context of mutual visions, and shared benefits. Number 11, create the tools needed to go to the market and execute the plan. Get serious and begin to act. Number 12, hold a vision day for all your salespeople. Sell them what's important around here, the vision, the company credo, and what's the institutionalizing of your vision. The benefits are from everyone to be committed and energy to skill the plain vision. Number 13, demand loyalty, the values, the vision, the credo. Demand loyalty, the values, to the vision, to the credo. Weed out the non-believers. They are nor dumb. They agree with you. If they don't agree with you, they're not wrong or dumb. If they don't agree with you, they're just in the wrong ship going to the wrong direction. Create a sales capability presentation that supports your credo. A sales capability presentation that supports your credo. Number 16, practice the principle of concentration for all resources to back your credo. All your money and all your ideas to back your credo. Concentration is the secret to all economical success. Reward. Risk-taking to attain the vision. Don't just expect risk, reward your risk. Turn the credo into a cause by repeating communications to all levels. Do it in person. Get out in your office. Be the chief salesperson for the vision of the credo. 19, celebrate measurable success. Celebrate measurable effort. 20, once the vision is close to becoming a reality, once the vision is close to becoming a reality, create a new vision. People want challenges that benefit their lives. Recreate, refocus, redefine a new direction based on the same shared values. One last personal note, my father was in a nursing home for 4 years before he died. He had Alzheimer's disease and a progressive degeneration of the brain, and it took a while to figure out what to do when I visit him, when I would greet him. Usually, he said nothing. He just was just with his head hanging. He hardly know any comprehending anything I ever said. On a visit, I pulled out my calendar and started talking about my uncomping schedule. His head remained hanging as it went over the plans, hopes, and dreams. And when the moment happened that he's remained my directive, he lifted his head and said only one word. He said in weeks, "Then get on with it, son. It's time to get on with it. If you're going to be a leader, then get on with it, son. It's time for you to get on with it. If you're going to be a leader, you better get on with it."